Hey, Raghunath, tell everyone about our Patreon community.
Sure, Kasturba. The Wisdom of the Sages Patreon community is an incredible online yoga resource. If you like the type of yoga wisdom and culture we share on the show, then our Patreon community is a great next step. This is a listener-supported podcast, and any level of sponsorship will unlock a wide range of live and archive classes, talks, and even workshops.
Raghunath teaches, I teach, and we have a host of other excellent teachers on topics ranging from yoga philosophy, asana classes, storytelling, Ayurveda, kirtan, cooking, meditation, and a lot more.
We even have an incredible online bhakti 12-step recovery group.
So if you want to check it out, go to patreon.com/wisdomofthesages.
All right, let's get it on.
Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Live from Ramona, California, this is Wisdom of the Sages, a daily yoga podcast with your host, Raghunath, and co-host and senior educator at the Bhakti Center in New York, Kasturba Das. Welcome to the show, everybody. Welcome to the Srimad Bhagavatam study. I'm here with Mukunda Kishore and Harry Bull. Did a yoga class last night, Kasturba. Really wonderful class. Group of students, a bunch of people from New York, and Sherry Yannick was there, a regular Zoomer. Yeah. She lives right there. Totally surprised her showing up. Imagine if wherever you live, you find out Raghunath's in your neighborhood. I was in Sherry Yannick's neighborhood. And Zara, one of my longtime students from New York City, moved out there. And yeah.
Connections, Raghunath, connections.
I got connections. I'm here with Mukunda Kishore, and we went to his incredible vegan Jewish, you know, truthfully, I didn't know what to expect. Vegan Jewish deli. I thought
I'm expecting really good.
You know what? It was incredible. I thought it was just going to be a bunch of bagels, which it is, and I like bagels. But I had matzo ball soup. I had a Philly cheesesteak.
That's a Jewish thing?
It's not a Jewish thing. That thing sort of snuck in on the menu.
Okay.
All right. But my son had a Reuben, really good hot Reuben.
There you go.
And there was one other thing we got yesterday. Sausage, egg, and cheese bagel. It was great.
Vegan Mara, sausage, egg, and cheese.
We gotta have a talk with you in that commercial kitchen right there. I've got a plan. So that was a great day yesterday. Oh, and then we went. This is what you do in California. We went Formula One racing with the kids.
Oh.
Yep.
Okay. Formula One race.
Thought I'd share that.
I went to the Bhakti Center yesterday.
Oh, he went to the Bhakti
I didn't go
Center.
Formula racing.
Formula One racing.
No.
You found your pleasure from inside, not outside. Oh,
that's right.
I guess it's official, Mara. He's much better than me.
Where's your mind? Oh, right.
I know what you're thinking.
But I met some nice others.
Did you? Who?
You know, I met Yashoda Dulal Prabhu's brother-in-law named Akundarasa. Very nice gentleman. Akundar. And he's another. He came up. I'm listening every day. His wife is like, he listens every day.
It's amazing people listen every day. We don't know them.
I'm like,
I know. You're listening every day. You better at least go to Apple Podcasts and write something on that review. You go to Apple Podcasts, you write a review. If you're listening on YouTube, you got to say, what's up? Every time you listen to YouTube, just write a little memo. Hey, guys, what's up? Keep up the good work. Or pretty good. Kasturba, be nicer to Raghunath. You know, whatever comes out, blows out of your mouth. Oh,
excuse me?
Whatever you're feeling that day.
But you know what I was feeling? I was feeling it last night, Raghunath, because the kirtan was beautiful. It was Balaram Purnima, right? So we're celebrating. But it was also the culmination of the Swing Festival.
Was it the last day of the Swing Festival?
Yeah. And so that was the, you know, it was this year. It's 4 or 5 nights every year. This year was a 4-night thing. And, you know, it just proves what we always talk about. You know, Radha and Krishna you know, the origin of all existence, the male and female energy together on a swing in that very personal and intimate way, that Vrindavan mood. They're being swung on the swing. Everyone gets a chance to go up and swing them. And it seems like there should be nothing to derive from this very simple thing, right? You have a
right. You're just, what are you doing? Swinging these statues little, on a swing.
Tiny little.
How is this metal. Spiritual? How yeah. is this spiritual? And what happens? How do you feel?
But that music starts to play. And the point is this, is that it was getting, it's Bhakti Center starting to pack out again. So there must have been at least 150, maybe more people. Everyone's heart and mind is going in the same direction, right? I don't want to be on the swing. I don't feel like I need to be the center of the attention, right? I'm happy to see Radha and Krishna on the swing. I'm happy to be connected to them with love. Everybody's singing song, glorifying them, and everybody's feeling good. Everybody's feeling united.
Amy Stellar saying it was an out-of-body experience.
Out-of-body experience. You leave the body behind and you start to float. You know, everybody's floating together. It's so beautiful, right?
It's so bizarre, truthfully. Like, from an outsider's point of view, it's like, it doesn't make any sense. What? Yeah. What did he do? Like, I'm sure Amy Stellar, if you're listening, is one of our Zoomers. I'm sure people are like, Amy Stellar, what did you do last night? Oh, I went to this place. We put these little statues on a swing that we sang cultural songs from India, and then we swung the little statues back and forth. I'm sure everyone's feeling like you did what, you just swung the statues back and forth,
and everyone comes
it
up.
It just makes no material sense whatsoever. You're swinging little deities of God,
yes, and you know, and everyone comes up and offers little flowers, and then they swing them, and then at a certain point, you know, they pick up the flowers and then they throw them on everybody, and it's just like. Everybody's like so happy. Like, that's the greatest thing I've ever seen. You know, it's like, it's so simple, right?
It's so simple. And so
but everybody's
good.
So happy. You feel good when you set the ego aside and realize it's wonderful to just be part of this, just to be connected. I don't need to compete. I can just be part of this and feel love in my heart. Everything, there's no friends and enemies. There's no competition. It's just beautiful. Everyone's just feeling that upliftment. And it's such an esoteric, beautiful, deeply spiritual kind of thing, too. It's the highest love being celebrated.
Right. I'm looking at Amy Stellar's comments on the board. It's sort of like, you know, there's two types of people that get into bhakti. One, you're sort of like, yeah, you're checking it out. I like the philosophy. I love the sweets. You know what I mean? You know, and then there's the one they're like, I'm all in. I believe that, like Amy Stellar's like, I was looking into their eyes. And she's crossed that threshold.
Yeah,
she's looking into the deity's eyes.
Full Kool-Aid. Anyway, it was beautiful. So Buckman G there, she said, I'm listening every day. I'm an other, but I'm still around. I saw so many wonderful
others people. Others are real. That's the takeaway today, Mara. Others are real.
Okay.
All right, well, that's good news. It sounds like we had a great day. I missed Balaram Purnim, but I left my daughter in Laguna to celebrate.
Okay. Now, let's boys. Oh, I see. Because she's got a boyfriend there. You left her there, but she was like, I'll stay with my boyfriend today. Thank you.
Yeah, that was it. It's okay. I left my daughter at the temple. I feel good about that.
Good. Okay.
Mara, any announcements, Mara? Come back,
yes.
Mara.
Yeah, I'm here. We have Bhakti
like
Recovery Group
whipping
meeting.
Things.
Bhakti Recovery Group meeting today at 1 p.m. There's a Fun Day Friday with Jamuna Jaya for our Patreon members.
Fun Day Friday.
5:30. Mm-hmm. And then Jiva's leading a Bhakti Recovery Group retreat at Super Soul Farm in the beginning of October, October 4th through 7th. So if you're interested in that, you can go to wisdomofthesages.com and go to events or Sage Academy. I'm not exactly sure, but
I think it's Sage Academy.
Yeah.
We got to figure that out. It's like you got Sage Academy, we got events. We got to figure that. It's like,
got to get our announcements straight. This is going to be great. Huh? And then we got the Wisdom of the Sages retreat right after that, our autumn retreat with special guest.
Well, you don't know if there's any special
You don't know. Guest. You don't know.
All right. You didn't tell me if that's
the secret things going on here.
Well, if it was confirmed, it wouldn't be secret anymore, would it, Raghunath? So,
no, it's not. It's just secret. It's just secret.
But you know what else? Jiva G is going to be there's going to be an interview. She's going to be on Namrasa's show this weekend on Saturday.
Yeah, our very own Jiva G from Bhakti Recover Group is going to be interviewed on Namrasa's podcast.
The new morning.
The late morning program.
Yeah. I think that premieres at 1 p.m. Eastern time on Namrasa's YouTube channel.
And I think also his Facebook
late morning program
too.
And his Facebook page, Late Morning Program with Namrasa. All right.
That name of his podcast is so funny. If you lived in a temple, it's called The Morning Program. So to call his show The Late Morning Program is just such a great play on words, isn't it?
Well, also because it's at like 4:30 a.m., people commonly show up late for the morning program.
The late morning program. Yeah. Very good.
Okay. Now we have a nugget today. I don't know if you even looked at it. You seem out of it this morning.
I'm really out of it, man. I got back late last night.
I don't want to hear the excuses right now, Ragnar.
Listen, I'm still waking up early. You're sleeping every day.
Well, you do what you got to do to make it for the show. Make it, you know, you show up, you're ready.
I'm here.
You know,
I'm
with
here.
Your A game. Okay.
I'm here.
So have you seen the nugget?
Ready?
Yeah. And who's it from?
This is from Lame Deer.
That's right. It's from Lame Deer. Ragnar, I was walking.
This is where you got this whole thing, Ragnar. Because if you're listening to the show as an other, everybody on the show, when you get on Zoom, and try to get on Zoom someday live, everybody, because what I do is the show starts, I say good morning to everybody. And I'd say about 60% of the people on Zoom have a nickname that I give them. Mm-hmm. And Kostuba made this point today. Give yourself a nickname. Change your name on your Zoom, because Ragnar's going to make a nickname and you may not like it. And
I hope you're not about to offend the Native American chief here, Ragnar.
The Native American holy man. A very problematic name. His name's Lame Deer.
You don't know what Lame Deer. Maybe the Lame Deer has special insights.
If my chief and master said, okay, your name is Lame Deer, I'd be like, do over, please.
Maybe you don't know what lame deer really means. Maybe the lame deer was the deer that had the deepest insights. Maybe the lame deer helped
then
the
call
rest
me deer the with the deepest insights.
Well, but his name is Lame Deer.
Stubby, you are squirreling out of control today, my friend.
But well, I'll tell you
okay,
something.
Okay, listen.
Hold on. You quiet down. Okay. I'm going to mute you. I'm going to start muting you.
What's up with him today?
I'm just going to mute him. See, I can just mute you right now. I'm going to do it right now. All right. So no, I was when I came home last night after the program, rode my bike home, and you know I had those city bikes, so I dropped them off, and then I was
walking down. Wear a helmet.
Yeah. I was walking down my block, and the apartment building next door to me, like on the sidewalk, it has this little, like a little wall, and you can sit on that wall, and sometimes they put free stuff out there, and so they put out a bag of books, and one of the books was Lame Deer, Seeker of Visions. I picked it up last night.
Good for you. Picking through garbage, found a jewel.
I found a jewel. They also had Black Elk Speaks, but I already had a copy of that. We've talked about that on the show.
Oh, you could. I would have liked that one.
Well, maybe I can go get it this morning.
Black Elk.
See if I can get that and add it to your library. But so this is from Lame Deer, and this is really good, Ragnar. This nugget is so good, we could probably talk the whole show about it, but let's see where it goes.
Okay. All creatures exist for a purpose. Even an ant knows what that purpose is. Not with its brain, but somehow it knows. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's really interesting. Ants really know their purpose. They have a whole mission going on. And mm-hmm. if you screw around with that mission, like get out of here, ants, and you know, swipe them away. They're like, they regroup so quick. Like, okay, get your heads back on straight. We got a mission. Don't let this little barrier get in our way. We're going to keep going. We're going to get it back together. We're going to move this giant grasshopper's body down to the fort, and we're going to, whatever it is, they are back on track within a matter of moments.
Maybe it's the lame deer that spends more time observing these things than the other deer that are running around.
Maybe. I still just wouldn't want to be called lame.
Well,
okay. Only human beings have come to a point where they no longer know why they exist.
Read the whole thing again, Ragnar.
Okay. All creatures exist for a purpose. Even an ant knows what that purpose is, not with its brain, but somehow it knows. Only human beings have come to a point where they no longer know why they exist. Oh, lame deer. This is incredible. This is such a good, oh my God. We could spin this one out of control for many episodes.
Well, let's just get started. And I don't even mind talking the whole show about this. Although
it's instinctual in animals. They have a mission. It's not like you're finding some ant who's like, I got to find myself. You know, they know what their self is. They know what their duty is. Their dharma is built into their being. And I guess it's because of this facet of choice that the human species has, that we can actually choose to evolve or devolve or love God or just choose just to be on our own path in this lifetime or many lifetimes. And it's the turning over my desires to love God is what makes us a unique being. It's turning over my desires to upgrade, evolve instead of degrade and devolve that makes us unique beings. But we are so lost and we're sold so many dead ends. They're sold to us. Sometimes they're sold to us by our own desires. Sometimes they're sold to us by our own illusions or bad advice. Sometimes they're sold to us by our lower chakras. Sometimes
social media.
Sold to us by social media. Sometimes they're sold to us by Madison Avenue.
Cinema.
So yeah, they're just pitched to us and we're like, oh, yeah, I should be doing, what am I doing? And we get sold on these things and it's just confusing. And the deep down, we're looking for truth. And the other directive signs, like you're going on the highway, New York 87 North this way, the other signs are too confusing that you can't even see the sign that you're looking for. Mm. And you're just like, you know what? There is no truth anyway. It's one of those classic.
You get cynical.
There's what is truth? You start to see all the, this guy claimed this was truth. This guy claimed this was a truthful path. And you're looking at spiritual paths and you start to see them. You start to find fault with the path. And this is a very common thing because we're vulnerable. We want to protect ourselves. I don't want to get totally swept up in something that may not even be true. And then we find some fault with it. Look at how this guy applied spirituality. That's completely bogus. And then we start getting very cynical and we start to think, well, you know, the Catholic Church, they steered me wrong. And this guy and this, he professed this, but look what he did. And this seemed completely, this seemed real. I followed that. And then and you start thinking, you know what? This is all counterfeit. There's nothing real. Everything
is no purpose to life.
There is no purpose. And it's just like, purpose is whatever you make out of it. Mm. And we're here to say, just because you've been dealt counterfeit bills does not mean there's not a real currency. Just because they're counterfeits doesn't mean there's not something real. It's easy just to say everything's counterfeit. It's all counterfeit. It's all fake. But there is truth. And we're not asking anybody out there, hey, join our religion. We're asking you to investigate truth, apply truth to your life, see how it works. And if it makes a little sense,
take swing a little rod and Krishna on the swing.
then get those deities on a swing and swing them right back home. Look in their eyes and cry.
Only when you're thoroughly convinced. Stellar.
She's very evolved at this point. Take tiny little steps forward. You don't have to put on a robe. You don't have to put this is 2.0 Krishna consciousness. You don't have to put on a robe. You don't have to move to an ashram. You don't have to sell your car. You don't have to shave your head. Take tiny steps forward in your practice of devotion. Bhakti yoga is not a weird thing. It's devotion. It's devotion of the heart towards the center.
So I want to ask you a question, Raghunath. Let's go back to lame deer. All creatures exist for a purpose. What Sanskrit word would you use here for
dharma?
Purpose? Dharma, right? Dharma. In other words, okay. And so he's saying that this is something that is a central idea in our bhakti lineage, right? Mm-hmm. That not only every person and not even every creature, but everything has a purpose. Everything is designed with a purpose. There's a designer that is integrating, you know, everything, right? And everything has its place and its purpose. Maybe we've discussed this before, I'm not sure, but until recently, and I'd imagine many within the medical world, many people still profess that the appendix has no purpose. Right.
Yeah. It. Oh, yeah. Has no purpose.
But whenever I would hear that, I think, come on, man. It's like, you know, because I'm of the faith.
Like God just made this extra organ. Just I'm gonna put this one in there too.
Yeah, but you know, within more recent years, people, you know, from the medical world are saying, oh no, there is a purpose to it. They think they figured it out. Mm-hmm. You know what it is? You know what the purpose of the appendix is?
I don't know what the purpose of the appendix is.
So within the intestines, and the whole digestive system, I suppose, you know, there are healthy bacteria that help us digest.
Mm-hmm. Right? Go on, Professor.
Okay. But you know, you might have like a dysentery or something like that, and your entire gut may kind of get like washed out. You know, in all of your healthy bacteria, you know, it may be missing, or you know, due to some other exposure to something, it kills off all of your healthy bacteria. Well, the appendix is just like this little bag that hangs off of the intestine. And so even if the intestines get kind of like cleared out, that bacterial culture remains there in the appendix, and it can repopulate, I suppose, the intestines with that healthy bacteria again. Right? Interesting, yeah. Right?
So everything has a purpose. Even the little bugs, even the annoying bugs, you know, that are crawling in your kitchen, they have a purpose there.
Right.
Yeah.
And so now, so here he's saying that every creature has it, but he says, Lame Deer says, even the ant knows what its purpose is, not with its brain, but somehow it knows. Somehow it knows. And what would we say is that somehow?
The super soul, the super soul within the ants.
Yeah, the super soul is saying, hey, join the line. Be part of this project that we're working on, you know, like move
that
grain.
Grab that giant cricket that's dead. Let's tear that body apart.
It's going to take all of us. Let's do it.
Let's do it as a team. We can do this. Stay in line, please. Stay in line, please. Your super soul is really organized.
But the thing is, the human, only the human being has come to a point where they no longer know why they exist. And that is a difficult situation to be in. And honestly, my guess would be that like Americans of, you know, of the 21st century are experiencing this probably more than anyone in history, right? It's like we're living in this bizarre world, right? Where there's like, as you were saying, there's so many counterfeit ideas of what is going to bring you happiness. And you know, like even you take the whole idea of like what America is built on.
You can be anything you want.
You can be anything you want. You can be a millionaire. You know, all you have to do is work hard enough for it and you will get there. You know, be determined. And you know, the fact is, if you look at it like statistically, like there are very few, like 0.00001% of us become what we are all dreaming of becoming.
You're just not trying, Kostuba. You're just not trying. You got to work harder. But you know, focus, power of intention, Kostuba.
And even when people enter that 0.01%, they're not necessarily happy. Like the rock star, you know, like I want to be famous. I want to be sexually, you know, like attractive, you know, like on a mass scale. I want to have money as much as I need to spend. You know, I want to be able, you know, like those things that like everybody's dreamed of. Hardly anybody even get, everybody's aspiring for it. Hardly anybody gets it. And even those that get it, even, you know, most of us just end up in kind of like quote unquote mundane, you know, the vast majority of people, they work, they have kids, they work, they have to support a home. They got to deal with all this, paying their taxes and doing this. And we, you know, we all end up there.
Or like you're saying, even if you do get it, it doesn't live up to what it's cracked up to be. Like, okay, right. I'm famous. Now what? Yeah. Okay, I'm beautiful. People recognize me. I get validation. Now what? Oh. I've got a huge. I can have all the money, resources I need. Now what? Now and there's what? There's this now what feeling, because the what we're doing is not the tied into the what we should be doing.
It's not tied into the purpose.
Yeah, yeah. Right? There needs to be purpose with that passion.
Okay.
There needs to be purpose with that.
Okay. And so this purpose of life, without it, you feel empty, you feel confused, you feel bitter, you get cynical, right? Mm. Like, what is the purpose? And when things get a little heavy, then people, they go there, right? What's the purpose to all of this? What is the point of life? Usually we're just moving, trying to pursue the sense pleasure, and we're not even thinking about the purpose. And then sometimes when the sense pleasure seems to be so far out of reach and the miseries seem to be so all-consuming, we say, is there any purpose? There is no purpose. Right?
So this is why I think in Vedic times, purpose or our work in this world, right? We all have some work in this world, but work was tied into liberation. It's not just you're doing what you're good at doing. We all want to be good, right? If you're a leader, lead. If you're a musician, play music. If you're right, if you're good, if you're a speaker, speak. But the your speech, your leadership, your music has to be tied in somehow or other. There has to be a bridge from our work to our liberation. And maybe it is directly. Kostuba, you're a good speaker. You're a good teacher. You're teaching about bhakti. That's like a direct link. That's a very short bridge. But somehow we have to figure out how we fit in our work with our contribution right? Because sometimes our contribution to the world is actually harming the world. We're part of something that's actually creating harm. So we have to think about like that. What can that be? What can be done? Or else we'll be working, or we're getting fame or something. But it's going against who I essentially am and my own personal liberation. Mm. You could be a great leader, but be leading people to, and you feel like, yeah, this is what I'm born to be doing. I command people. People like to listen to me. But how am I leading them? Hey, I'm with Makunda Kishore. This guy is incredible at business. It's incredibly, impeccably organized. He's got multiple businesses. He and Govardhan, they have this whole chain of that they're starting of these Ben and Esther's vegan delis. And they're incredible. And they're just like, it's like easy for him. But also, first of all, they met with Radhanaswami. How do we offer this food? How do we keep this prasad? It's like the way they're thinking, how can we distribute prasad is so beautiful. You know, how can I contribute? You know, they contribute. Makunda's contributed so much to everything that we do on Wisdom of the Sages. He contributes to Super Soul Farm. He's created a bridge where his work and his effort are connected to his own liberation. So we don't want to feel busy doing nothing. That's a lousy way to feel in this age that we live in. It's okay to be busy, but we want significance in our busyness, or else we feel really empty. And that's a sad way to be working hard. And I don't know why I'm working.
Hmm. Yeah, sure. And so getting back to that, I mentioned earlier that like there's this fundamental concept within our bhakti lineage, within our philosophy of life, that everything has a purpose, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone has a purpose. Everything we are, including the soul, the self, is designed with a purpose, you know, the very soul. And so this becomes really important. And this is where the topic of Dharma gets a slightly more nuanced, but in a very interesting way. And I think in a way that, will be very interesting and practical for people. Yes. And that is that it's said that there are two types of dharma, right? Two types of purposes. Hmm. And one is called Naimittika dharma, and one is called Nitya dharma, right? So Nitya dharma means?
Mara, let's get Mara on the hot seat. She's done nothing today except whip things with her whipper.
Mara? Eternal dharma?
The eternal dharma, right. And so then Naimittika dharma means?
Temporary.
We could say temporary, or let's say relative dharma.
What did we call this the other month ago?
Oh yeah, well, that was a
functional concept. Functional work
and we have a fundamental identity, and we have a functional identity. So the fundamental identity is tied to the nitya dharma, to our eternal purpose, and the functional identity that we have, the function that we play in this world, is tied to the temporary or relative dharma. And I'll explain that a little bit more, but it's like this. It's said that every living being shares the same nitya dharma, or the same eternal dharma.
Okay.
And that means whether I'm a human being of any gender, of any race, of any nationality, of any age, doesn't matter, of any species, even of like animal or plant, every spark of spiritual energy that's illuminating and bringing to life any type of body, whatever it may be, every living being shares the same eternal dharma. What is that? It's devotion and love and service, right? To serve with love. That's what I was talking yesterday about, that woman I saw with the three-legged pit bull, right?
Oh, yeah, three-legged.
She was so happy because she was playing out her purpose, and it was to serve is our nature. You know, Prabhupada, can you think of the example I'm about to give? Right, with Prabhupada talked about, he gave an example of someone serving and just showing, you see, it's the nature to
serve.
Guy
with the toilet paper.
Yeah, yeah. He once in 26th Second Avenue, which was the very first temple Prabhupada started, which is just a tiny little storefront on the lower.
How are we thinking the same about all the stories? We think the same, you and I.
Well,
and
I mean, it exemplifies that that well, I think.
I think it's more of a miracle, Prabhu.
I don't think so.
I mean, there's a lot of stories about Prabhupada. We thought about the exact same
well,
one.
Because
toilet paper.
Okay. Well, in any case.
Okay.
So, whether it's a miracle or whether there was a very clear logical connection, so Prabhupada was speaking.
I believe in miracles.
Okay.
It did too. Your sexy thing goes to her.
Oh, the dog just barked. Oh, God.
Please. Okay, so Prabhupada was speaking at 26th Second Avenue. This is like 1966. And there's a recording of the class. And he's speaking. And, you know, there's the front door that people come in. But then there's a hallway in the building. And there's a little side door that's right near where the speaker speaks. Mm-hmm. And right near the bathroom, which is this tiny little bathroom. And so this, out of nowhere, while they're speaking, homeless, or do we say non-housed person walked
non-housed.
In?
We call it non-housed now.
Non-housed. Sorry for triggering you.
It's the same exact thing. Homeless.
I know. It's just any case. He walks in. So a non-housed person walked in the door.
It's housed. No, Kostuba. It's housed. No, we've changed it. Okay. That's the new way they say it now.
So in any case, this man walked in, and he had a roll of toilet paper. And he just kind of walked into the middle of the lecture out of nowhere, looked around, opened up the bathroom door, went in, put the toilet paper in there, and walked out. And when Prabhupada saw it, he just said, just see. You know, it's like everyone has this nature to serve. He wanted to help.
Threw the thing of toilet paper at everybody.
No.
Okay. No. I misunderstood that story.
Okay. So the point, and I'm giving the example of that lady with that dog the other day. But yeah, it's being said that within us all, within the ant, let me grab the grain and help out here, you know, let me help my brother.
This is another thing going on right now. You know, in this world that the media, and they're really doing it, media is getting worse than ever. It just draws you in to hate someone. It draws you in. Things are going wrong here. Let's find an enemy. And if you could just crush this enemy, then I got news for you, whether you're in the left wing or the right wing, if you crush your enemies, you will not be happy. They're trying to make an enemy out there for you to hate, and it's all it's getting at people is hateful. The fact is, for the most part, people want to love and serve, and they have different ways about going about it. And I get that. Some people are confused about it, and some people are not confused about it, and some people are.
So let's work on the confusion.
Let's work on that confusion.
Yeah.
And what's going on is we're just creating hate. People have a desire to take care of other people. People are generally have a kind heart. People generally want people to be happy and want there to be happiness in this world and want to be fair. Of course, there's certain people plagued by greed and envy and lust, etc. For the most part, I believe people are good people. So that desire to want to give love and serve is a very beautiful thing. And what we say is, keep it going, people. Keep going straight ahead with a desire to serve and love, but direct the center of that towards God.
And that's part of the design, right?
That's part of the design. But we've gone so off track, and the culture doesn't really endorse it. Matter of fact, culture now is trying to take the whole damn thing down. You know, there is no God. It's just anything. And, you know, there are others out there that are trying to ruin your life. And if you just kill the others, then you'll be happy. You just learn how to hate better.
Okay. You got that off your chest, Regan? Take a deep breath.
Mara, all right. What's up? What's up today, Mara?
What's up with
this guy today? Because Stu have to have a wrestling match, I think. You're gonna get up here for Ashram week next week.
No, you sound like you just needed to get that off your chest. That's all I said. Okay, so then and so then.
By the way, Mara sent me a picture. Mara, Bhakti Lata, Bunky, Lev. They're all at.
They're all up there now.
Super. They're all up there. Super Soul Farm for Ashram week started today.
Wow. Ashram week started today.
Starts today.
I thought you were gonna be there for the start. What are you doing, Raghunath? Get over there.
I'll be there Sunday.
Okay.
I think Raghu just lost his mic.
Oh, you just lost your mic, Raghu.
But when I got there to Super Soul Farm yesterday, I picked up Bunky from the train station and delivered him.
Wow, and, long time since Bunky's been there, huh? This has been
yeah,
like
yeah. And there was this huge double rainbow completely over
Get
Super Soul
out.
Farm. I'll send you the picture. It's like unbelievable. And so I was about to leave, but I had to call everyone else out of the house from like sitting at the dinner table to come see this because it was incredible. So I sent Raghu the picture, but I'll send it to you too, Kasuba. Yeah, I'll share it with everyone.
Are you back, Raghu?
Am I back on?
Yeah, yeah, yes. We can hear you.
Yeah,
double
it's
rainbow.
Like this,
huh?
It's like what a Krishna miracle. You want to talk about Krishna miracles?
I'll give you that one.
Show up for the first day of Ashram month. There's a double rainbow over Super Soul Farm.
I'll give you that one.
Come on.
And it was only over Super Soul Farm. Like that rainbow didn't go over any other of the local area.
It was completely just over.
If you saw this picture, you'd be like, you know what? I believe in miracles.
Okay.
That's what you would break into that song.
I'm even without seeing it, I'm accepting it. It was a miracle. Okay. So now let's get back to this, Raghunath. Okay, let's get back.
This sexy thing, yeah.
Enough, Raghunath. Enough, please. Don't ever sing that song again. Okay. All right. So we're talking. So we all have this design. This is again fundamental to what we're saying. Is that every living, everything has its purpose. Whether it's a pen, whether it's a pair of glasses, whether it's a living soul, inhabiting a human body. It's designed, for a particular purpose. And it's being said that every soul is designed to love and serve God as the root of all existence. Mm-hmm. That's our nature. And naturally, consequentially, that love will expand to every living being who is a manifestation of the energy of God.
We've thrown the map away. And I think a lot of us getting into bhakti, it's sort of like, hey, there's a map. I didn't even know there was a map. And now we're starting to like, okay, who am I? What am I supposed to be doing here? What's the direction? Where am I driving this vehicle? I've got the vehicle. I've got a great vehicle. I just don't even know where to go. And so a lot of us are just sort of like putting this into our, just trying to figure this out. Okay, where is the compass? Tell me where to go, Tom. Remember Tom Toms? They were big for about a year.
No idea.
They were before we had iPhones, Tom Toms. And so that's what I think is a very big, important question now. Who am I? What am I doing here
okay.
in this world?
So now let's take this further, right? That we're talking about the Nitya Dharma, our eternal purpose. And we're saying that we all share it. But at the same time, we're all individuals. We're all different. We have different minds. We have different bodies. We have different circumstances that we're living in. And time also changes throughout our life and creates new circumstances, right? So it's said that we also adopt temporary purposes, right? Naimittika dharmas. It's a dharma, it's a purpose, it's a role that we play. It's a role that comes with expectations.
Wife, I'm a husband, I'm a parent, I'm a son.
It comes with privileges and it comes with duties, right? Mm-hmm. And by living out that purpose, that dharma, it ideally when they're well designed and well applied, they make use and they bring out the good in you. They make use of your talents and your skills and your abilities, your aptitudes. Mm-hmm. And it also recognizes the weaknesses that you may have and addresses those and weakens those and improves you as a person. And this is the point. When the temporary dharma is designed and applied well, it brings you towards uncovering that eternal dharma which was within you all along, right? It helps you uncover or rediscover your divine love that is your eternal nature, right? So then you play the, like you said, my temporary dharma may be I'm a mother, maybe I'm a father, and maybe I'm a wife, and maybe I'm a husband.
Right? I'm a joker.
You may be a midnight toker.
I'm a
that
smoker.
That would be your temporary. It's more likely a dharmic, but I'm not going to be judgmental here. Midnight Tokers, you know?
Midnight Tokers.
Particularly Midnight Tokers, you know?
Oh, our generation, a Midnight Toker.
But you maybe right, you know on. your dharma may play out in terms of your occupation, or should play out in your temporary dharma, right? Like, again, let's say it plays out in the you're there with Mukunda Kishore, right? He's got a certain aptitude. He knows how to do business. He's successful at it, right? A lot of people might try to start a restaurant and it collapses, right? They can't get it off the ground. Yep. He's got a chain going. He knows, he can see how to organize it, what the right idea is, how to make it work. You know, he's got that. And then he's got employees, right? So now the dharma, part of the dharma, the temporary dharma is now he accepts that temporary identity, right? I am a business owner. I run this restaurant, right? And then he accepts the duties that come with it. It is my duty to care for all my workers, to see that they're paid well enough that they can get by, right? To see that they're treated with respect, and that the working atmosphere is conducive for their own spiritual development.
No, Kostubji, this was such a big thing with Gopal Chandra Prabhu, who just passed away. We have responsibilities in this world, and when we're really on the ball, we do identify with that functional dharma, right? There's worry. I'm sure in the back of Mukunda Kishore's head right now, he's thinking, oh, those employees, oh, my manager, I hope he's doing well.
With headaches.
What did you call it? A house of headaches?
I said it comes with headaches.
Comes with headaches. Yeah. It's a head of headaches.
We're a house of headaches.
And you're thinking about them and you're concerned about them. And a parent's like, you know, parents always concerned about the kids and the one kid who's struggling. And are they doing okay? Parents are always concerned about, Mukunda Kishore is really concerned about his wife's mother who's going through it right now.
Sure.
And so this
that's
is part of
the, that's part of his dharma as being a husband and a son-in-law.
Exactly. And when Gopal Chandra Prabhu was, you know, getting ready to pass, you really had to coach him through, listen, you've done your debts. Your debts are paid.
Your temporary dharmas are done,
right?
It's all eternal dharma now. Yeah.
Because we do have debts. There's people that have taken care of us. Our parents have taken care of us. Our workplace takes care of us. But my employees, I take care of them and they take care of me. My children need me. And you go through this point, the whole time we're cultivating this nitya dharma, this eternal dharma, this eternal fundamental dharma
and love, yeah,
right. And so, you know, and there's that famous verse, Devarshi Bhutaptan Rinam Pitrinam Nakinkuranayana, something like that,
yeah.
And so, I was telling Gopal Chandra, I was like, you've done it, you were a great husband, you've
what
done
does
it.
What that verse mean?
Okay, the verse means, you owe debts to everybody. You owe debts to the demigods. You owe debts to the forefathers. You owe debts to the country. You know, we're getting taken care of by the country that you live in.
Parents, to
right? Yeah. Sometimes people join the armed service and they think, you know, I got to give back. You know, my country is taking care of me. You know, sometimes we owe debts to the parents. We are debtors. But they say, as soon as you take shelter of the lotus feet of Lord Vishnu, all your debts are repaid.
Go and right to the root.
Right. You go. And so my coaching, my life coaching to Prabhu Gopal Chandra was, hey, you've done it. You're a father, debt paid. You're a husband, debt paid. You're a son, debt paid. You've done everything in the material world. You have one debt more, and that's your debt to Krishna. And that's where we have to be right now. Don't go to any other. Oh, wait, the bill has been paid. You've already done that. That bill has been paid, right? When you pay off that credit card, you don't have to go back and check your credit card statement. It's been paid off. Now move forward. Now the biggest debt, we have a debt to Krishna. Krishna's our dearest friend. He's done so much for us. That's the debt I have to focus on. That's going to take care of all debts. And you really get that when it's end of life. Mm. But we have to cultivate that now. And then when end of life comes, you realize, yes, I can do nothing else. For my mother, for my children, for my home, for it's all taken. Now I just have to reconnect with that original debt. And what does Krishna want? What's the payback for Krishna? He wants you to just love. Now it's exclusive focus, my love, on Sri Krishna. Where is that swing? So I give him a little swing.
Okay, I look in his eyes.
Look in his eyes, throw a little flower.
But so going back to lame deer, He's saying even the ant knows what its purpose is, but the ant doesn't have a mind that's disallowing it to hear the message of the super soul in the heart.
Right.
You're part of the team.
Put it.
Right. Yeah.
There's not an ant going, you know what? I'm going to rebel. I'm going to be a rogue ant. I'm going to drop out.
Or I'm just not satisfied with this anymore.
I'm going to start a band.
There's no meaning to this. There's no meaning to this. You know, the ant doesn't have a midlife crisis, you know?
Yeah.
But the human does, because our minds are fed with so many images and so many ideas of where we're going to find our happiness and what we need to be happy and so on. We've lost touch and we're not hearing the message of the super soul. And I think, it's super common, incredibly common, that people feel like their life really didn't have, you know, we may say my purpose was my kids. That became the purpose of my life, you know, like, but like in terms of occupation, I think like maybe majority of people don't feel like this is what I was born to do, or this was what, you know, this is deeply meaning for me. No, I go there, I make some money so that I can take care of my family and kids. And that's my purpose, you know.
Create the bridge. People
Yeah, and tie the entire thing. Take it beyond family.
Look at Mara. She's like, oh, that's a takeaway. Create the bridge. Is that?
But take it all, bridge the entire thing to that root of all existence. And then the whole thing ties together. Now, we live in a mixed up world. It used to be that, you know, you would kind of, your temporary dharmas were kind of all laid out for you. You know, if you grew up like in a more particularly traditional Indian, what to speak of, quote unquote, Vedic society, right?
Right.
You know, my father was a doctor, I'm going to be a doctor. And it was no big deal. It was like, well, this is perfect because he knows how to do it. He can train me up for my, when I'm a little kid. I don't have to go and learn all these other things that won't be so important, you know, and you know, I can take over caring for the families that he's caring for. And it's just a natural fit. But yeah. You know, we don't like that idea. We want to be more independent, you know, like the American mind. You know, we don't want to do what our parents did necessarily.
You know, there's that great book, you know, that book, Mara, that I like, Nine Lives. People should read it. It's an interesting book. The story about these nine different people, these different experiences with this author's traveling through India. And one of them was how they make deities. Like, we fall in love with this because, you know, we go on pilgrimage and we see the father who makes neck beads, who makes Tulsi beads, and we see the son working also. And he's 8 years old. It's not child labor. I mean, it is child labor, but it's not like it's an abuse of child labor. This kid is going to grow up and he's going to inherit the entire business. And his work is directly connected towards his spiritual dharma as well. He's making, you know, these Tulsi beads that all the devotees wear. So in this one story, we hear about a person who's from a long lineage of deity makers.
Wallace, like Murti Wallace.
The Murti Wallace. And there's ways to do it. You have to be being born into the family. And there's different rules about when they start making the deity in a particular phase of the moon and how to carve it.
Yeah, there's a little pride in it, and that's okay, you know?
Yeah, pride of their work. And of course, there's some self feeling of worth within their work. And then he's saying, yeah, this has been going on forever, but my son's really not interested. He's getting into computers, actually. You know, it's like the end. We're approaching what could be the end of these family lineages in a lot of ways.
Right. Sure.
And yeah. Anyway, that was my little side story.
Okay.
But I was thinking how you and I, or everybody who goes on pilgrimage, we see people it's inspiring where their external dharma is connected to their dharma, and they're raised that way, and it makes so much sense. And we are sort of lost.
This is
a world of choices.
I think people do feel lost, right? And even though we have all these choices and we're kind of raised with the idea from when we're kids, you can be anything that you want. Still, we don't get to a place that seems to be fulfilling all our desires. You know, we kind of end up in places that we didn't necessarily dream of, you know, out of necessity, you know, and just out of the shifting changes that just took place in life. And then we're sitting there wondering what's the meaning of it. And it may be, if we're very fortunate, we may be in an occupation that feels deeply meaningful to us. Just the work itself is meaningful. You know, set aside the money and how I use it. that the work itself feels deeply meaningful and satisfying to me. That fortunate is the person that feels that way, but we don't all feel that way, you know, particularly as we're working for these larger corporations. It's not like we even own our own businesses and our own shops, and, you know, it can be like that. But so here's where I think here's like an important message, right? It's that my temporary dharma, my job or so on, my occupation, it may not be in any way, it may not have a direct connection to my eternal dharma, but there are ways that I can tie it in, and there are ways that I can tie my entire life into that, you know. So it's not, if you see that higher purpose, that eternal dharma, as your goal in life, then we just have to try to mold our temporary dharmas around that. Some of them, like being a parent, may be easier to do that. And then if I work for Kmart or something, it may be more difficult to do it, you know. But we can see it that way. Maybe we want to change it, or maybe we stay in it because it'll be too disrupting to change it.
Sure.
But our life will become full of meaning when we tie all of those temporary dharmas to the eternal dharma.
I like that. I like that, Kastubha. Okay. Our life will become full of meaning when we tie our temporary dharmas to our eternal dharma. Right. Mara, somehow make that concise.
Okay. Mara, work on that. And what was it that I wanted to say? Oh, no, I forgot.
Sorry.
Oh, no.
Spiritual flow.
In order to do that, you see, we may embrace the temporary dharma, even being a brahmana, temporary dharma. You know, it's like, you know, maybe I'm a spiritual teacher, you know, maybe that becomes my temporary dharma, but still, it's not who I am eternally. Mm-hmm. It's a role that I play temporarily. And so therefore, the bhakti yogis, to cultivate more that strong connection, we have to spend time entirely focused on the eternal dharma. We have to spend time every day entirely focused on the eternal dharma. We have to spend, you know, exclusive time, you know, throughout the month. Like yesterday was a special holiday. Let's focus on it. You know, at times of the year, like these retreats that we're doing and so on, you know, and ideally years of the life. Like, and that's something that we eventually want to get together where you can take a whole year and be part of like a training, you know, and really become deeply immersed in it. Even like, again, we do the Bhuta Shuddhi when we do our puja, right? You sit down and before you do the puja, you chant this prayer. I'm not a Brahmana. I'm not a Kshatriya. I'm not a Vaishya. I'm not any of these occupations. I'm not any of these temporary dharmas. I'm not a mother. I'm not a father. You know, I'm not a husband. I'm not a wife. What am I? Mara?
I'm a spirit soul.
Okay. That was
a servant of the servant. Yes.
Of?
She's good. She's good.
She is good.
Stump her every day.
Yeah. Of Krishna, and specifically, do you know how Krishna's
servant of Radha, or of the servant of the gopis?
The lover of the gopis.
Yep.
Yeah. Gopi Partha Kamala Yordasa Dasa Anadasa. I'm the servant of the servant of Krishna, the lover of the gopis. That's my eternal dharma. And whatever
vegan
I'm doing,
that one.
Vegan chakra. Yeah. And whatever I'm doing that's a temporary role, whether it's something that, you know, if I'm fortunate, it neatly fits into that. If it's a little bit more difficult to tie it in any case, I'm tying it in. I get up to work so that I can make money to serve Krishna. You know, I take care of my family because they're all connected to Krishna, and we're all, you know, we're all connected. We can tie it all in, and our life will have dynamic purpose and meaning. And when so much so that when we just have little deities of Radha and Krishna, we put them on that swing and we're singing the kirtan, we'll feel the deepest spiritual ecstasy within the mind and heart, you know. And then we can let go of everything.
We are pure spirit souls.
That's, and
that's
it.
What we have to keep reminding ourselves. I'm not a Brahmin or a Vaishnava. We may not even be able to relate to that. I'm not a man. I'm not a human. Sometimes we'll say, well, I'm only human. You're not. If I call myself human, I'm putting myself in a very limited box. I'm not human. I'm not an animal. Sometimes people say, I'm just an animal. You're not an animal. You're not a human. You're not an animal. You're not a boy. You are a pure spirit soul. That's what I have to remind myself on a regular basis. That's what a great yoga teacher will do. Remind the students that they're pure spirit souls. And once we have that in mind, then I'll act differently. I'll make a different choice.
Mara,
takeaways. Go.
When you set the ego aside, you can feel love in your heart.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, man.
Others are real.
They sure are.
Those are real.
Ants don't need to find themselves.
They don't.
No.
Just because there are counterfeits doesn't mean there isn't real currency.
Yes, that's a Ragu.
Take tiny steps forward in your practice of devotion.
Take tiny steps forward in your practice of devotion.
Okay. Even the appendix has a purpose.
It sure does.
Our work should be tied to our liberation.
Yeah.
Our passion needs purpose.
Yes.
Our passion needs purpose. The purpose. The passion. That was a Sheldon song. Purpose. Passion. It was later.
The purpose. The passion. Interesting.
Create the bridge to the root.
Create the bridge to the root.
Okay. It's kind of mixed metaphors, but yeah, we'll take it.
And maybe the lame deer has the deepest insights.
Yeah, maybe it does.
Maybe right the lame deer has the deepest insights.
Thank you, everybody. You were so lame today, everybody. But lame is good insights here on Wisdom of the Sages. Ah, you are the rainbow in my life, Kostuba. Do you know that?
Oh,
you are the rainbow.
Double rainbow.
You're the double rainbow. You there are the double rainbow.
I saw the photo. It was incredible.
I don't care. Where is everyone seeing this photo?
Mare sent it to me.
On what? How, everyone's like, oh, great photo.
What does it matter to you how she sent it to me?